If AI is the rocket, what makes AMD the launch pad?
We have accumulated a wealth of IP and technology.
How do you see this evolving over the next couple of years or beyond?
I think you're going to see a lot more inference moving to the edge.
Hey, everybody. Really excited for this chat today as we dive into AMD's AI vision and strategy with a true insider. Ramine, how are you?
I'm good. Thank you. Thanks, Evan.
Well, thanks for being here. I've been really looking forward to this chat. Before we get into the details, perhaps introduce yourself, your role, and the big picture. What is AMD doing in AI right now?
Sure. My name is Ramine Roane, and I'm leading the group in the AI group at AMD.
And what AMD is doing in AI right now? Well, we have products that can accelerate AI from the endpoint all the way to data centers. So at the endpoint, we have AI running in self-driving cars, in satellites, even on Mars, on the Mars rover, in hospitals doing analytics and genome analytics and things like that. And then we have AI PCs on laptops and desktop at the edge, and then the big Instinct GPU in data centers.
Wow, it's an amazing portfolio, amazing breadth of technologies. And central to that vision is open source, which is very impressive. Maybe talk about that and how does AMD approach that rather differently from others, perhaps?
Yeah, so for one thing, our entire stack is open source. So the ROCm software, which is our software stack to program our GPU, which was first specialized for HPC, since AMD is really big in HPC. We have like the top two or three biggest supercomputers in the world. And then we have, maybe 3 years ago, we have adapted that to AI, which uses, smaller data types, like more FP8, FP4 than FP64, like HPC. So we've done our first AI GPU in 2023 and adapted ROCm to do the whole AI stack. And everything is open sourced. And we also very quickly realized that companies are actually using open source software. Like if you look at OpenAI, they're using their own branch of VLLM, which is a open source software for inference serving. And xAI uses their own branch of SGLang, which is another open source software. So we very quickly started to work with the open source community. We provide them with machines to do daily CI/CD and work on supporting all the features and all that. And it's just super important, not just for enterprise, but even big AI labs. Everybody is using open source.
Absolutely. And you talk a lot about not just the software innovation, but combining that with hardware leadership, tremendous synergy. How does that show up in real world performance?
We came up with our very first GPU in 2023, and we started to sell it in 2024. And we basically went from 0% market share to 5% market share in our first year in wow. AI against the biggest, baddest GPUs out there, right? So we're extremely competitive. Our customers are not small. They're, the open AIs and Metas of the world.
Yeah, it's amazing. And you have so many developers, so many examples of where hardware-software synergy has already delivered results. Can you share any of those stories or anecdotes, examples where you're getting really measurable performance or efficiency gains?
For one thing, our GPUs are not just competitive in compute. They actually go way above and beyond in memory and memory bandwidth. That's because we have accumulated a wealth of IP and technology on the EPYC side. Namely, we're chipletizing our devices. It's not just 2.5D. Like we have the memory hierarchy and the IOs on the first floor, and we have the compute on the second floor. And that allows us to pack a lot more compute in the same device and put a lot more HBM. Just to give you an idea, when our first AI GPU came out, MI300X, we had 192 gigabytes of HBM. The biggest, best, number one GPU out there had only 80 gigabytes. So wow. We were like almost 2.5x more in terms of memory, and more than 1.6x the bandwidth. And obviously, LLMs are extremely hungry, not just in memory, but also in memory bandwidth, at least for the decode side of LLM is very memory bandwidth intensive. And that's why we got very quickly adopted by the Microsoft and OpenAI and Metas of the world. So it's a combination of hardware and software, right? Because then on the software side, things are moving very quickly. But honestly, the state of the art in software is no longer proprietary. There is no proprietary mode. It's really open source. It's what VLLM and SGLang are doing. No proprietary stack can match. They're moving way too fast. So on the software side, we're taking advantage of our memory bandwidth at the same time as keeping up with the state of the art, because we were directly working and developing with open source.
Fantastic. And clearly Frontier Labs and others are betting big on AMD for AI. Okay. And a lot of that is through partnerships, really helping shape your future as well. Any lessons or insight into those partnerships and the partner philosophy that you're driving?
That's really key, actually, to any product development. You want to work very closely with the users of your technology, whether they're customers or partners, and understand the gaps that they're seeing out there and fill those gaps. So we understand the gaps, work with them, work with the internal engineering team, propose solution, and the solutions that customers really echo well with, we implement them.
Yeah, back to the basics. Love it. Mm-hmm. You mentioned AMD technology is on Mars. I love that analogy. I'm a space tech geek as well. So if AI is the rocket, what makes AMD the launch pad? You know, what's the mission control behind the launch? You got people, partnerships, platforms.
I would say the launch pad is the community. It's really the community. The open source community is nothing would take off without them at this point of time. Again, there was a time where proprietary software was the only thing available, and therefore the state of the art. That time is long gone, and really without open source, none of that could happen. Yeah, we have great technology. Yes, we have advantages on chiplets and 3D packaging and all that, but none of that would take off without the open source community.
Yeah, it's fantastic to watch. Let's talk ROCm 7, your developer platform. It kind of evolved from being an AI software stack to much more. Maybe talk about that evolution and where it is, where it's going.
Sure. So ROCm 7 is a big change in that we completely re-architected ROCm. We trimmed it down, modularized it. It's completely open. Right now it's on a GitHub called The ROC. So it's AMD The ROC. And you can install just the pieces you want. And at the same time, we've been keeping up with the needs out there. So we have a full enterprise AI stack. When an enterprise company is buying our GPU, what do? They need a way to bring up that stack and start distributing workloads and using the GPUs efficiently every hour of the day, right? So we have a full-fledged enterprise stack, which is also open source, that's out there. We actually announced it in wide availability just today. So we have a blog on our website with all the links that are needed to access to that. And another big thing we're doing in ROCm 7 also is to catch up to a new trend, which is distributed inference and disaggregated inference, because now that Frontier Lab are inferring at least as much as their training, if not more, inference efficiency has become a big thing. And one thing that the open source community really figured out is that by disaggregating prefill and decode, so prefill is the part of the LLM that analyzes your prompt, which could be, for example, a whole book, right, to summarize. And decode is the part where it's just generating, right? By disaggregating those two phases and running them on different pools of GPUs, you actually get much higher efficiency, because they're just specialized workloads that you don't want to run on the same GPU because they're going to start interfering and slowing each other down. So that's disaggregated inference, and we also enable distributed inference in ROCm 7, which are things like for mixture of experts, for example. You can run different experts in different GPUs. You bundle experts and run them on different GPUs, and then you have to take care of all the GPU to GPU communication. The GPUs actually communicate directly, bypassing the whole networking stack running on CPU. So all of that is coming with ROCm 7.
That's fantastic. Are there any particular industries or workloads that you think will take advantage most and kind of stand out here?
Definitely LLMs. that's one of the top use cases, although we're also running things like diffusion, search, ads. We have customers now really across the spectrum, video generation, image generation. But a lot of those are either attention-based or diffusion-based, or just classic ML for search and recommendation. Those are the workloads we're mostly focusing on.
So it's a competitive landscape, obviously, in AI, and you know, reducing deployment costs is crucial. Total cost of ownership is being looked at. How do you think about ROCm 7 helping organizations, enterprises achieve, you know, these goals?
Cost is very, very important to our customers. For inference, just like for training, you just need to try to get to maximum utilization of your GPUs. That includes using as many GPUs as possible, but also using as much compute as possible in the GPU and generating tokens really, really fast. For the compute and for the power consumption that you have, right? So things like distributed inference are basically meant to optimize ROI. So it lowers the cost per token, basically.
Any real world examples or benchmarks delivering cost efficiency?
If you infer LLM the old way, which means how we were doing it 12 months ago, compared to using disaggregated and distributed inference on a cluster of GPUs, you can probably slash down the cost of token somewhere between 10, 20, 30x.
10 to 30x. Wow, that's blockbuster. Amazing. So moving a little bit away from the present, there's a lot exciting happening, but maybe talk about the future of AI compute. How do you see this evolving over the next couple of years or beyond? Any insights you can share there?
I think on the inference side, honestly, as edge devices become more and more powerful, I think you're going to see a lot more inference moving to the edge. In a few years, cell phones will have the same power as a data center GPU today. So yeah, that's how I see it. I see that inference will move more and more to the edge, to the endpoints, and eventually, in a longer time frame, even training could with federated training. Right, this is more like 10 years maybe from now. But I don't think we're going to continue this unsustainable gigawatt consumption for AI. This is all going to go down, just like the Cray was using 100,000 watts, and now it's using 4 watts in your pocket for 6 billion times more power. This is what's going to happen for AI as well.
Well, fantastic to watch. So if we were to jump ahead to 2028, like in the Back to the Future movie, and what sort of milestone or breakthrough would you see signaling that AI's AI vision has really come to life? What would you hope to envision there in the future in 2028?
I guess the one single thing I want to see by 2028 is AI proving a theorem that humans have never proved.
Wow.
That would be a major breakthrough.
Like that would be incredible.
One of the millennium problems or something like that, or finding unifying the theories that Einstein never could, right? The coming up with quantum gravity or something. That would be fantastic.
Well, that would be. And I don't think we even need AGI to get those kind of breakthroughs. Speaking of the future and other topics that are, might be relevant, do you think we'll see quantum computing at real scale and real utility, real use in our lifetime? I know you're involved in different
in our initiatives lifetime. I'm skeptical, honestly. Okay. I think we're going to see a lot of improvement in quantum computing, but one of the biggest problems in quantum is that those qubits are actually not stable at all because, you know, they're in a quantum state. If they interact with any other particle, they collapse. So that's why it has to be in vacuum. It has to be close to zero Kelvin. You shouldn't have electromagnetic wave passing by because that's like a photon hitting your particle. It's very, very finicky, very, very sensitive. I think we're still pretty far from having stable quantum bits.
Well, it'll be fascinating to watch for sure. Speaking of technologies I'm excited about, I just recently got an AI PC actually powered by AMD. Okay. And I do a lot of cool local stuff involving editing and video and AI locally. So I'm excited, but I'm a tech geek. I'm an early adopter. Do you think AI PCs are going to really take off? Maybe we'll see more at CES this January, or, you know, is this still mostly a data center cloud story?
Just the rate of improvement will make AI PCs in a few years, like in a year or two, I think AI PCs are going to be as powerful as the data center GPUs of maybe three, 4 years ago. And that trend will accelerate. Yeah, I totally believe it will take off.
Well, good to know that investment was well made. And a final question here, do you think we're in an AI bubble? All the media and journalists are super hyped on this topic, or are we looking at growth that is really backed by fundamental change?
There is a big shift happening in compute, and that's basically turning regular algorithms, like optimization type of algorithms, and even algorithms that we could never write before in regular CPU programming, we're turning those algorithms into deep learning. And the reason we're turning them into deep learning is because deep learning is almost 100% parallelizable. The algorithms we had before had, let's say, 20-ish percent a sequential core to it, and that's why with multi-threading, we could never improve by more than 5x, right? If it's 20% sequential, 80% parallel, the best you can do by using maximum multi-threading is to get rid of the 80%, but you still have the 20% left, so you accelerate it by 5x. With deep learning algorithms, you don't have that. It's almost all parallel, and you can accelerate an algorithm by 100x, 1,000x, 1,000,000x, 1,000,000,000x. You can keep on going. And that's why we're not just accelerating algorithm like in HPC and all that by turning bits and pieces into deep learning, but we're creating new algorithm that we could never have done before, like image recognition, video generation, LLMs. So all that requires a shift in computes. And I don't think we're in a bubble. I think we're just shifting to a new type of compute. It will eventually calm down. We're still in our exponential phase. It's eventually going to settle down in a few years. Now, yeah, there is a lot of excitement. Maybe there's some overexcitement in bits and pieces of the market. But in general, I don't think we're in a bubble that's going to burst in a year or two. I don't believe that.
Well, I could listen to you for hours, but sadly, I have to let you go. Thanks so much for the insights, the insiders' perspective, and a brief view of the future at AMD. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you, Evan.